To be sitting here with Rasheed Araeen, whose retrospective opened in December, and really delighted that Rasheed came back. He wasn't planning to come back, but Rasheed, by a horrible stroke of irony, is not here for his own opening, so it's wonderful to welcome you back today for this talk. And I hope many of you, either today or over the past, 2 months, had a chance to visit Rasheed's show. It was wonderful to walk around it again with Rasheed, and wonderful to hear the amazing response it's had, both here in the Netherlands, well, slightly mixed in the Netherlands, but internationally. So thank you, Rasheed, for the exhibition. I want to begin by asking the same question I asked Tony Shakar, which was, why do you make art?
You have made me nervous. Why do I make art?
I can give you a prompt from our earlier conversation, if that helps, which I think is somehow would be interesting to hear Tony's position. You said when we were looking at a piece in the museum that art is there to make the world better.
That's very contrived. Do you want me to be honest?
Yeah.
But without being intellectual, I would say I wanted to earn my living, also I want to be famous, I want to be a celebrity, and as an engineer, I could have earned my living, but I might have not become famous.
And your dream in life is to be, I'm on a celebrity, get me out of here. Sure.
No, I don't want to be a celebrity. That was something I dreamt of 60 years ago.
Which is a nice place.
Which brought me to Europe. First to Paris, then to London. I thought Paris was something romantic. I could live a romantic life like Picasso. But when I reach Paris, when I saw how people live, how people behave, what was the aspiration of people, I realized it wasn't the Paris I dreamt of. So I left Paris. I thought maybe London would be better. And this is how I ended up in London.
I want to take you back a little bit. And what we're going to do is kind of just to prompt, show some images from the exhibition and also some artworks. There's quite a few, so we'll go through them relatively quickly. But I want to take you back, Rasheed, to Karachi, when you're in Karachi and working as an artist in Karachi. Talk a little bit about the dream then. What was the dream? You didn't have a training as an artist.
No.
You had a training as an engineer. So was the dream then to become an artist, or were you still quite realistic about the fact that this dream might not be achievable?
Well, while I was studying engineering, with the hope that would lead me into architecture, somehow somebody in my earlier time, when I was young, who saw my drawings, suggested that I should take up architecture. Otherwise, how would I have known that it would have been good for me to be an architect? So a lot of ideas were put in my head by other people. So I said, okay, I would become an architect. But there was no training of architecture in Karachi. There was no school. So I thought, I better go into engineering. Although my parents wanted me to be a doctor, because it was more secure professionally. But I didn't have any inclination to be a doctor. I liked to draw things and make things. So I thought engineering would be better. That's how I ended up in engineering college.
And when you're doing your engineering training, is it at this time are you making portraits like this?
Well, I had a parallel life. Both as a studying at the same time. Since I developed interest in drawing, which was initiated by my mother when I was 6, 7 years old. One day my mother asked me to help her to draw some flowers for her embroidery work. And that's how I began to draw. And while I was making flowers for her, I was told later on, I didn't realize myself, that I made improvement on what I was given. Also, the place we lived, it was a remote place from urban modernism, or modern urban cities. It was a fishing village, there was no sign of modernity except for radio. Some people did have radio.
Radio.
Yeah. And there were no toys for the children. So my mother sometimes would gather children from their neighborhood and ask them to, she would prepare some clay and ask them to make toys. And that is how we would make toys. So I had a training and interest at that time, drawing and making something with the clay. And then when I entered school, by the way, I was quite late in my entering in school. I went to school at the age of 11. Before that, I just bump around, look at the nature. As a child, I worked as a farm boy.
You worked as what?
Farm.
As the farm boy, okay. Okay.
My family, actually originated from peasantry. Poor peasantry. Half of the time between until I was 7-8 years old, I spent in the fishing village in Baluchistan, which was the semi-desert area. Half of that time I spent north of Pakistan. Which is not now, it is no longer part of Pakistan. I meant the north of that area, which is now in India, which is very green, lush, very fertile area. But both of my family, mother's side and father's side, quite poor. Although one time they must be affluent farmers because they had very nice houses still, but no land. So as a child, I did everything which they would do in the farm. I was sent to cut sugar cane. I was made to carry a big bundle of sugar cane to bring to our house. Not house, we had a special place where we cut the animals. We had a machine to make to extract juice from the sugar cane to make sugar. So I worked on that. I would put in front of the machine, which was run by bullocks. And my job was to pick up a sugar cane and feed them to the machine. I was sent into the field to look after the buffalo, something like that. So I had all those experiences. Also because of poverty, we didn't have enough to eat. So my mother and my younger sister, we would get up early morning at 5 o'clock, even in winter. And we have a very, very cold winter that area, which is very near Kashmir, to pick up things from the floor. After they harvested wheat, some of the wheat would lie on the floor, on the ground. We would go and pick them and collect them. Sometimes we had to go and pick cotton, for example. That's how we survived.
So Rasheed,
I'm sorry, I have to tell her these things, which has nothing to do with what you say. I think this is more important than that.
Well, we can publish your autobiography. But Rasheed, we will speed up, otherwise
no,
you'll miss your plane.
I'm telling you, because all these things have gone into my sensibility.
So Rasheed, you're in Karachi, and there's one work in particular I just want to talk about from this time in Karachi, which is my first sculpture. And I would like you to tell briefly the story of this piece and why it was important, because you're painting portraits, you're painting the gardens in Karachi, you're going to an artist club on Sunday where you're painting from life, you're very much working within a kind of representational approach to art, you're depicting the world around you, and then you have this moment where you come across this piece of wire, and what happens then?
I didn't know it was important. You said
it. Here we go. Okay.
And the critics said it is important.
You called it my first sculpture. I mean, it's kind of dramatic, you know?
Yeah, after 50 years.
And you kept it in your studio all this time.
Yeah.
You kept it sitting in front of your desk, there are these pieces of twisted metal.
No. At the time of the action, at the time of actual act, it had nothing to do with art. I was walking in the street. I saw a piece of metal lie there. You know, it's like you're walking in the beach, on the beach. Mm-hmm. I do see some pebble and something like that, which is interesting. You pick up and take home. Everybody does that, so I didn't also. Very similar.
Sure.
So I said that piece of metal. Lying in the street. So I said, well, it looked interesting. So I went and picked it up and I took home. I had a table in my room, same table which you see in the room, with a lot of things. So I put that piece of metal on the table and I started looking at it. My mother came in she said, what is it? What do you do? What is it you brought home? It just came out of my mouth. This is a sculpture.
But nothing to do with art. Nothing.
No.
No.
I knew the idea of a sculpture. You know, so that's how it became a sculpture.
And maybe we talk about the burning tires afterwards when we get to the 70s. But I mean, for me, in the way that we've talked about it before, is that this is an important moment where a transition takes from art being something that can be concept, idea-based, rather than representational. That's the shift that happens in the work. And the work then starts to go from a representational realm into abstraction and starts to become function more on the basis of ideas rather than the kind of the world. representation. And this series, Boats Towards Abstraction, which is upstairs, is the kind of key moments, no, where you're no longer sitting or standing in front of the port at Karachi, depicting it. You're in the studio, drawing it from, painting it from your imagination. That's the shift that happens.
You are doing a better job than I would do.
So you just nod and agree. And this series of paintings. This series of paintings, which I made just before I left Karachi. This is the series of paintings that you made just before you left Karachi called Before the Departure, where this move into geometric language becomes...
You are pushing me into what they call intellectual. You want me to be intellectual?
No. Let's move into the second one.
Okay. You want me to do something intellectual. Okay? There are three events which took place in Pakistan and Karachi, which are interconnected. I wasn't aware of that connection. Everything happened, all the things happened independently and intuitively. What is the word?
Intuitively.
Yeah. Before I pick up that piece of matter from the sea, something else happened 3 months earlier. I think I should tell you that is more interesting. It was very hot summer, month of August, in 59. So a friend of mine came over, he said, let's go out. It's too hot. Let's go to a park. So we went into a park, and it was almost sunset. Nice breeze began to come, and we just sat on the lawn in the park. Suddenly, a few children came over and start playing hula hoop. And my friend, who happened to be a traditional painter, he liked to paint realistically. Oh, he said, oh, that's a nice subject. I was going to make a painting of it. I said, come on. Oh, what is there to paint? It's so mundane and stupid. Children playing hula hoop. So we got into conversation. I was very critical of what he wanted to do. And he kept on defending himself. Suddenly, something happened to me. I went silent. And I began to see images. Not exactly what I saw, but vertically undulating images. I went into almost a kind of hallucination I couldn't speak. Actually, I've written about this in my book. I said to my friend, Mr. Karachi, I am not feeling well. Can you take me home? So he called a motor rickshaw. So he took me home. And so I went home, went into my room, sat on my, I had a small steady table in my room, I sat there. My mother came again. She said, should I bring you dinner? I said, no, I'm feeling hungry. So what I did, I took, opened the drawer, took some piece of paper, and drew vertical, undulating line. And you can see those drawings in one of the work up there. Next morning, I went to the art shop in the city, but a small canvas, and painted the painting, again, vertically undulating figures. I tried to depict what I had experienced in the park, but I surrounded by circles, which was the food. No, why I'm telling you, because the piece of metal I picked up, it was the hoop. Like the mud, which I picked up, took home, and called it a stuff. Week after that, can I vote? Week after, or 2 weeks, I forgot, I was standing on a bus stop. It was a big open ground. And I saw a bonfire where rubbish was being burned. I realized the piece of metal I picked up must have come off after burning the bicycle tires. I don't know why I thought I should also burn some tires. I can't explain. It is the job like my friend.
It's got nothing to do with art.
So I went to, luckily there was a second-hand bicycle shop around. I went there, picked up 2 bicycle tires, and put on the bonfire, and then I went my own where I wanted to go, came back in the evening home. On the way, I look at the bonfire, it has gone off. Among the ashes were 4 metal pieces. So I collect them, took home, and that became the other work, called burning bicycle tire. As simple as that. Now, the idea of fire was already there in the first painting I did, the vertical undulating meter. also followed that, I did a series of paintings which are entitled Fire and the Dance of Fire. I hope this will make some sense.
And so, Rasheed, I'm going to ask you some very specific questions about your arrival in London. As you say, you went via Paris. Paris was not what you thought it was, the capital of the arts. And you're working in what was BP, British Hydrocarbon, as an engineer. You see this work, which, well, not this particular work, but the work of this artist, Anthony Parrott, which has a deep impact on you. It's important that you brought some of your paintings with you, didn't you, from Karachi to London, and then discarded them. Well, not discarded them, but certainly put them to one side.
Under the bed.
Under the bed. and so, when you're at work working with an engineer, you start making some of these drawings. And this is the drawing.
Not immediately, no.
A year later.
Yeah. Took my time, yeah.
And in that time, you're not making any work.
Well, what brought me to Europe was my madness.
Your madness.
I want you to be a big artist, you know, celebrity, rich. So I could send money home to my parents, they would be happy. Mm. There was nothing intellectual about it.
Right.
It was art material, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what did your parents think of this dream?
They thought I was a complete failure. Because for 50 years, nobody knew what I was doing.
And why did you...
So, as I said, the madness to become artist brought me here to London. So I wanted to make myself, I wanted to educate myself, you know, because in Karachi there was no education. There was no art college, there were no wisdom, there were no only books which we had imported from Europe. Here in London, I could see original books. So I went to museum, I went to galleries, every exhibition I saw. That's how I came across Anthony Karachi's work, which fascinated me to the point of being upset with it. To the point that when I was offered a show to show my work which I had borrowed from Karachi, I said no.
You weren't comfortable with it.
I said, I don't want to know anything what I did in Karachi. I want to start again afresh with a new idea. Okay. To be just fascinated by work, by somebody's work, doesn't take you anywhere. You can become a his or her follower, imitator, which many sculptors were actually doing in the early 60s. Everybody wanted to be Anthony Caro. And you know, they have disappeared. There's nowhere to be found. Luckily, I didn't have resources to follow him. because to follow him, you need a studio, you need the time, you need the money, which I had none. I had to work to live, so I got a job as an engineer. But idea of a sculpture didn't leave me alone. And I began thinking about sculpture. So, and I, at the end of 50s, almost about 18 months after I arrived in London, I was just scribbling around during the lunch time in the office where I was working. I drew symmetrical girders piled on each other without thinking what I was doing. Suddenly it occurred to me that I found something new. That was the beginning of my, what the art historian called minimalism.
And Rasheed, if I could be so dare to think intellectually for a while, at what point did you think about your use of geometry and symmetry in terms of ideas rather than just form? I mean, you said that you drew it quite intuitively, but geometry and symmetry has a particular meaning and resonance for you. And when did you?
At the time when I became fascinated by Anthony Carter's work, it must have been the use of his use of geometry. I didn't realize that at that time. I didn't either realize that the work I had done in Karachi had a geometry. So it took me quite a long time to make a connection between my work in Karachi and what it had. Particularly the boat series in which I began to use triangles, triangular form. So it was in some sense a continuation of my interest in geometry. Although consciously there was a gap, but unconsciously it itself got connected.
And could you say something specifically about symmetry? Why the interest in symmetry?
I would just like symmetry. I can know, speak the importance of symmetry because I've read so much what other people have written about symmetry. Particularly Michael Newman's reference to a French philosopher who written a whole book about the geometry and symmetry.
But these were, I mean, in the interview that you did for the film upstairs, you talk about symmetry as being the possibility or the idea that would allow us to become more equal. If within symmetry, there are literally one side is equal to the other. So it has an ideological.
Yeah, but I didn't begin the whole thing with the idea that I'm going to produce something which would make people equal.
No, that's what I'm wondering. When
it
did that?
It came on much later.
And I'm going to go through quite quickly because time is pressing. In 1968, you win a second prize in the John Moores Art Prize, yeah. Which is this first sort of institutional or establishment recognition for you in England. And it's a moment where you kind of see the door to the dream opening.
Yeah, yeah.
A crack opening.
It was a nightmare. It was so let me correct. Dream became a nightmare.
When did the dream become a nightmare?
In the 71.
71, okay. And why?
I suddenly realized London wasn't what I imagined. Somewhere you could be free.
You were an idealist, and it.
I realized. I was naive and ignorant. And didn't know that London was the capital of an empire. And its institution was still based on their imperial legacy. Once I discovered that, I went through nightmare. And it was Fanon who helped me to get out of it and asked me to be positive. And I became creative again.
How did you come across Fanon?
By chance. I used to go to bookshop and browse. For Saturday, I saw the book. I thought it was interesting.
And Rasheed, I put images from the Swiss cottage where you made for Olawale, which was not until 75, but the process began in 1971. And this is the kind of a key turn in your work, both in terms of the politics directly entering the work, but also in the type of materials that you're using, the processes that you're using. It's a very, it's a shift. But why is this work, it's dated 71 to 75, what's...
Oh no, 73.
73.
It was reconstructed in 75 on the request of David Medalla.
And when did you meet David Medalla? David Medalla, a Filipino artist who runs...
At 71.
71. He was running Signals Gallery, which is an incredibly important space for showing international art in Britain. Yeah. And you meet him in 71, and that's where your interest or exposure to politics really begins.
Yeah.
And you, at this point, you join the Black Panthers.
Yeah. Let me say something. I was always interested in politics. To the point, I was already active politically. In 67, I joined a group in London who campaigned for the restoration of democracy in Greece. I don't know if you have a memory, it was the army takeover. They were the junta. It was the army coup who abolished democracy and so we campaigned against the junta. And by the way, during time I met Malina Mercury. I took her photograph, it lying somewhere in my archive. the point I was making, that I was always interested in politics. I also was involved in anti-Vietnam War demonstration in 68. But I always kept politics separate from my art. In 71, when I went to this nightmare, they came together. That separation between politics and art collapsed. So when they became together, came together, I faced a new problem, how to deal with it. So in dealing with this, what came out as one of these work, Nick had been the referee. Yes.
And I think it was, I'm showing the image of the holes in the earth now. have I got an image from upstairs? No, I don't. Actually, I'll leave that. I'm going to go to Black Phoenix, which this is the cover of the first edition. So in 75, you write, I think, was Black Manifesto your first piece of text, the first extended essay that you had written? Yeah.
Yeah.
So you write preliminary notes for Black Manifesto, which is written in 75 and then published in Black Phoenix. 78 is Black Phoenix, yeah.
Yeah.
And why do you turn to publishing? Why do you make a magazine?
Well, I realized the problem I was facing was too difficult and complex. You need to do something more than just making images. You have to write it down. How you feel, what is your analysis of the situation, why you face what you face in an imperial capital, all those things. My idea was to just write a couple of pages and send to a sort of a statement, send to an art magazine. But when I start writing, I couldn't stop. It went on for 3 months. I become upset. I can become tied with the typewriter. Sometimes I wouldn't eat. It was very hard work, but I was upset. Sometimes it would take, I wasn't a writer. I had no discipline of writing. So I had to struggle to write. Sometimes it would take whole day to write one page. I would write, tear down, throw away pages. I wish I have collected them all together, would have become a very good artwork. One of the first conservative artworks.
And so, Rasheed, the Black Phoenix only lasts 3 issues. You run out of money.
Yeah. I have an answer to you. During all this nightmare, I went there. I did a lot of reading. Anti-colonial struggles, writers, Fanon, Cabral, Mao, Marx, who you mentioned, Lenin. And that's how I became interested in writing. I realized there was not enough literature around. Not the right kind of literature about the creativity and art from Africa, Asia, and the rest of the world. It was all about white artists, European artists. All the magazines showed what was shown in the gallery. After I wrote the Black Manifesto, I realized I couldn't be only one who felt like that. There must be many people in Africa, Asia, who wanted to say something. They might have written something, which we didn't know. We needed a publication by which we could give them a platform to speak of their own act. That's how. Also, there was a practical problem. I realized I might not be able to publish Black Manifesto otherwise. So I said, why not start my own publication?
Take yourself.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I mean, not only are you starting writing.
I had some experience of publishing while I worked with the Black Panther. We used to publish what they call newsletters every week. And it became my responsibility to go to a printer. It was a self-help printer. You have to print your own things. Lay out, then make a plate yourself, and then run the machine to make the whatever you want to publish. It was a horrible place. It was a run-down building. It was a community press. While you were working in winter, the roof was leaking, you had to put something on to cover to work. Anyway, that gave me experience how to publish something, which went into publishing Black Phoenix.
And then there's a huge... Well, there's a, what, 8-9 years between the end of Black Phoenix and the beginning of Third Text?
Third Text,
yeah. In that time, you're also experimenting with performance. Which
I did a lot of things in this performance, slide projections, speaking in the conferences,
compared to the
denouncing imperialism. No wonder I had so many enemies.
We're going back to your wish to be famous. Was this?
You stupid! I should have not done that.
Well, you were doing an important thing. But were you?
You can't buy the what you got a hand with you.
Can't buy the hand of peace.
Can I vote?
So I want to go because we're running out of time a little bit. I want to jump to the 1980s, and you talked about this moment in the 70s where. You know, politics, the kind of collapse happened. You had separated art and politics, but the politics enters the work, or you feel that it has to enter the work. And you've talked before about this kind of these two elements of your work, a political awareness and an aesthetic sensibility. And at a certain moment, there's a kind of pendulum, and it goes really in one way, and another moment, it goes back to the other. But this moment in the 80s, it seems to be that the two are very much speaking to one another somehow on equal terms. You're combining your minimalist interest in geometry and symmetry with direct political imagery.
You become a Soviet again.
You made it.
That's all.
You became a proper artist. and maybe we could, because the 80s was also incredibly, you're making these series of works, the Cruciform series, you're also, it's the building up, I guess, to the launch of Third Text in 1987, you're organising exhibitions with young black artists in Britain,
yeah.
And then of course in 1989, the other story.
Yeah.
It's an incredibly busy time.
Yeah.
Where were you getting your money from? Really? I mean, no, but seriously, did you have a studio?
No.
So you were making these things, paintings at home, making.
Yeah.
And how were you organizing?
Luckily, I had a lovely wife. I still have, after 52 years. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's extraordinary.
Who inherited some money from the family.
Right.
Which helped us.
Okay, so could support you.
Yeah.
But having said that you got into art to be famous, this is not presumably a very glamorous existence at that point, when you're organising these shows, writing, you're not doing it for the fame anymore.
I don't know. maybe underneath it was still desire to be famous.
Right.
Who knows?
A different type of fame.
Notorious.
Yeah. And then, the first edition of Third Text comes out in 87, other story in 89, which took, we should say, 11 years to be realised.
Yeah.
This incredibly seminal now exhibition that happened in 1989, which Rasheed organised, which was first proposed to the Hayward Gallery in 78. Took them a very long time to realise, as they have done on many occasions, that what you're saying was quite significant and should be listened to. But in 1989 it was finally realised at the Hayward Gallery. And then by the mid-90s you stop making work. Mid-late 90s, you stopped producing work.
Well, I made some work early 90s because the South London Gallery wanted to show me.
The Cruciform series. But yeah. By the mid-96, 97, you're just working on Third Text.
Yeah, mostly, yeah.
And that happens for about 10 years. You're making some, you see some of these kind of...
Take one example. 1896. I made only one work on the whole year.
Which was?
With the 40 we said.
Takeji.
Yeah.
Which was shown in Middlesbrough.
Yeah.
Yes. And then you end the text. Your relationship with Third Text comes to an end, shall we say? And you return to Karachi for a period of time, just to get away. It was quite a...
No, by the end, after 86, I was going every year because of my death of my father.
Okay.
And my mother was alone, so I had to go.
Okay. And you returned to Karachi having finished with Third Text, and then you start to paint again.
No. Last work I did that period was 98 in Sydney.
Okay.
Big destruction. From 98 until 2010, I made no work. I made a small drawing, which are highly political. Nobody want to look at them. It involved relationship between imperialism and hardcore pornography. If I can use the vulgar term, what has been fucked up by imperialism? This is what the work has been about. I have kept them hidden because nobody wanted to see it. But I didn't do any big work during that time. So I felt fed up by 2010. I said, why are you hitting your head against the bloody brick wall? Do something else, get away from here. So I went to Karachi, opened my studio, and packed all my work, which I had done in Karachi. Put on the walls. I had myself 5-room apartment, empty, in the house where my brother also lived. So I converted it into gallery space and a studio. So I make drawings and told my younger brother to help me to make paintings. This is how I begin to make artwork again. Mm.
Yeah. And also the references that you start to think about are quite different, no?
Also, I begin to read about Islamic civilization during that time, or the golden period of the Arabs, Islamic, from the 9th century to 15th century.
Which Tony was referencing.
So I went through the work of a famous philosopher, Ibn Sina, Ibn Rushd, and I came to know there was a close connection what the Islamic philosopher did, what happened in Europe during Renaissance, then followed that Enlightenment. So there was a close connection between Western, so-called Western civilization and the Arab culture and civilization, that which led me to this work in Karachi, and I call it homecoming.
Yeah. A series of those upstairs. It's 5 o'clock, Rasheed, and you need to be in the car quite soon. So I think rather than carry on, I think it'd be nice to open it up to questions are any. So are there any questions? Yes.
I have a question about when you started collaborating with the British Black Panther Party. At some point, I believe I read somewhere I found somewhere the information that you stopped collaborating because there were a lot of internal struggles in the British Black Panther Party. Is that correct, or do you want to elaborate on this? Or?
No. Black Panther collapsed.
Yeah.
In the end of 1973, it collapsed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Compared to the American part, it was much...
No, there were internal problems.
Yeah.
Fighting for the domination among the groups.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a fight and... actually, there was the question of property.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We had two houses in London, North London and one in Britain, which were purchased with the money given by John Berger,
mm-hmm.
from his prize, what they call it. Yeah, not Turner, other one. Literary prize, but I don't know what they call it. Yeah. Anyway, eventually become a question who owned those properties.
Okay.
There were in files, and its whole thing collapsed.
I didn't read the catalogue yet, but perhaps it's an open door. But the last part of the exhibition, it strikes me so much that it reminds me of Arabic decoration, of Islamic decoration system. Is there a link with that in your
Why
work?
You call it the decoration?
when
craft.
You see the
craft.
The art. No, the in the mosque, you know, all those the ceilings and you see. It's sometimes only in the last part of the exhibition. Then I think, is there a possible link with it or an influence, perhaps?
Yeah. You're right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's and because I'm now looking at this work also, and then I suppose that these are Arabic characters. No,
they are
say something or is
that's,
it?
Yeah,
they
is
are done after 2010.
Okay.
Yeah.
And does it say something or is it just
their names?
No, they are not saying anything.
Okay. Good to know. Thank you.
But I think also here...
If you look at the piece of beautiful pottery, you know what I'm saying. If you come across a beautiful piece of pottery.
Yeah.
What did they say to you?
Well, it depends on the poetry, I suppose.
Pottery.
Oh, pottery. Mm. Oh, I thought you said poetry. Pottery, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, no, yeah. You enjoy the beauty, I suppose. Or the function of it. So. Pottery.
This is beautiful. No?
Yeah. Oh, well, it's functional also.
Does it say to you anything more?
Listen carefully in speaking.
Yeah. You can put your water and drink it.
Of course.
Yes.
So thank you for bringing me home in this building, specifically where it's impossible to feel at home. And I have a question to you. I want to ask you, how did you experience this conversation?
How did I experience
it? In relationship to the work of Rasheed and what it tries to say.
Rasheed and I have talked a few times, so... you know, this is... I mean, I think whenever you talk to Rasheed and understand or hear some of the stories, As Rasheed says, it kind of gives another type of reading to the work. It's very easy when you're particularly working in a place like this and producing books, as Rasheed says, to become very bogged down in the intellectual activity of the work. It's very nice then to take a different register and approach to the work, to hear it about these, the roots, the genealogies that come from very different places. So it always adds another layer.
It was very interesting how the form of the interview was very persistent in relationship to what Rasheed and his work and everything he embodies tries to kind of reiterate or kind of relate to differently. It was very interesting to see the insistence of the system you kept on reproducing, even though he was keep on trying to kind of open another door. It's really fascinating.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it's also just a way of trying to structure an hour. I mean, I think, the
and it's not an offense.
Yeah.
It's a reflection, because we all are trying to kind of find other positions to relate to this.
Yeah, totally. And I think what's also really important for me is to try and underline the consistency of the ideas across 60 years of work. Although the forms are incredibly different, and at first glance you can say, okay, you're seeing a series of different smaller exhibitions by different artists or something like this. You know, when you actually track the trajectory and try and track the trajectory with Rasheed, there you understand, why the triangles that are being painted in the late 50s appear again here in 2012.
I mean, he tries to introduce an idea. I don't want to speak of you. So I understand that what Rasheed and his work tries to introduce is a form to kind of destabilize the notion of finding a line from that notion of categorization, which is rooted in the colonial, in the imperial itself, and tries to propose the kind of the sudden, the surprise, the formless that generates form that you can call triangles or whatever. It kind of, and it's embedded in stories, in motherhood, in land, in whatever, in many different things, which he tries to reiterate. And that is exactly really kind of the other story. No? It's kind of, it's just really interesting.
I can relate to what the lady is saying, that there's a lack of representation. Obviously, I really like your work. I don't understand contemporary art at all, but with your work, I thought, wow, I can understand this. I'm an engineer turned economist, and I'm an activist, and I run into art because I see of the power of it to mobilize people. I want to mobilize my people to be involved in the construction back home, my origin from Afghanistan. So it's great to see the work of Islamic pottery or whatever. But my question is, what do you feel, what should happen with contemporary art institution or public institution? Should there be more open, or should foreigners themselves organize themselves and demand more more say or present themselves? So the question actually is, who should take charge, who should take responsibility? Maybe you can elaborate on that.
There's no point for me to say what contemporary art should be, because I have no power. Power lies with the art market.
Art market, yeah. And you're in a free market, right?
With the museums, with the collectors. Whatever they want, artists are going to produce. I'm also producing because the museum began to like my work.
No, that's exactly my point. I'm talking about public institutions. I pay taxes, I'm
asking. But the museum hasn't determined my direction. That may be the difference.
the end, did you become a celebrity?
Pardon?
Have you become a celebrity?
I hope not. You want to kid me?
Yeah.
I would like to ask, do you still enjoy making your art?
What?
Do you still enjoy your art?
No. I enjoy eating. I enjoy cooking.
You do go to the studio every day?
No.
Okay. you have a big studio. You go most days.
Yeah.
We're still producing a lot.
Yeah. Now people were making art for me in my name. Unfortunately.
It's almost 15:15. Unless, are there any more questions?
When I looked at your paintings, or mostly the writings, I thought something struck me there that it was so actual. Nowadays, still the political issues you mentioned already in your writings are still there. And it also made me a bit, how do you say, sad in some kind of sense, because we're still fighting. 30 years further, 1970, we're still in the same. When you read the text, you can literally now look at the news and they're the same issues. What do you think about that?
It is more important what you think about it, not me. I've done my job. I don't want to know about it.
I think, sadly, we will have to leave it there, Rasheed, because you need to get a plane.
Yeah.
Huge thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Say that you have 15 minutes left before the museum exhibitions close. So.